dodge this.
One world currency.
The new world order.
Those are the roots of trouble.
I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to do. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of election, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from federaljack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition of DTRH. It is December 10th, 2014. Tonight's live edition is my first live edition after coming back from a week and a half trip across the pond over to Europe. Took Marseille, my wife, you all know that she recently passed away, took some of her ashes over to her favorite city in the world, Amsterdam, her absolute favorite place on earth, one could argue, and I took some of her ashes back there and spread them out in a few special spots for her. And while I was over there, I also got a chance to sit back and look at our country from an outsider's perspective, which the last time I was over there was 7 years ago, right when I first started to get into all this stuff. And I had taken a wee bit of a break and went over there for about 2 weeks. And it was pretty bad back then, but it's gotten much, much worse. So tonight, unfortunately, I have to take our beloved country to the woodshed. I don't do this to lambaste this country and make us look like a bunch of assholes to everybody that's tuned in around the world. On the contrary, I do it because I'm really sick by what I see, and it's time for a friggin' reality check. It's absolutely abhorrent that people are allowing fear, racial divide, and other types of programming to control them. And you know what? I really thought this country was a little bit better than it's been acting in the past few months. And it's about damn time everybody admitted it. This racial tension that you see going on in this country is absolute bullshit. Let's start off with that. I sat down in coffee shops and hung out with people from around the world. Black people, white people, Asian people, Latinos, French, all sorts of Europeans, English, the Dutch, Belgians. We might have joked around with each other, but nobody had any racial animosity. None. I hung out with a bunch of guys from the UK. Half of them were black dudes. They were over there celebrating. It was a bachelor party because one of them was getting married in a month. We hung out for like two or three nights in a row because they kept going into the same shop that I hung out at. Did we not sit with each other because we were black and white? No, we did. That shit didn't even come up. It's absolutely ridiculous. People, this kind of stuff didn't exist 5-6 years ago. This kind of tension. Yeah, dude, Popeye, you're white privilege. Shut up. So tired of hearing this crap, white privilege and all this other bullshit. I have news for you. Do you know why they're doing this racial tension crap? Because everybody started to realize that the police state was around them, and they started to wake up. So what do? They have to. I keep telling you, they're pushing everybody for a violent outcome, right? So what do? They want to start a civil war. Everybody starts to wake up and see what's going on. Oh my God, why were there tanks and why were they acting like, you know, the military? Remember, this is what they were saying. They weren't tanks, they were MRAPs. But why were these armored vehicles in the streets of Ferguson? Oh, it's because there's racial tension. They kept focusing on race. The media kept focusing on race. The politicians kept focusing on race. The race baiters like Al Sharpton and Jesse Scumbag CFR Jackson and the rest of them. All focused on race. It's because blacks, oh my God, they're so suppressed. And yes, black people, yeah, right now it looks like, yeah, black people are totally pushed down and suppressed like it was back in the 1950s. And there are certain spots in this country where they get a raw deal still. And yes, there are still racist assholes in this planet, okay? But let's be real. This isn't like it was back in the days of slavery. They're amping it up because they want people to have a civil friggin' war. They want people to riot. Duh. They want violence. It's the only outcome they can control. How many friggin' times do I need to tell you people this? And I don't care if you get mad at me for talking to you like this. Somebody has to talk some goddamn sense into this whole country. This is just out of control. I watch this from an outsider's perspective. You realize how stupid we look to the rest of the world? Go outside of this country for a week and a half. And go see what they see. We look like a bunch of bumbling idiots. And we're way better than that. This country is way better than that. And I expect more of you. And that's why I'm pissed off. And if you can't take it, too friggin' bad. People need a freaking dose of reality. I'm tired of being nice about it. Maybe I'm a bit cranky from the trip. Maybe it's because I got food poisoning from the airplane food when I came back and I was sick for 8 hours straight after a 16-hour travel, you know, route between flying on two different planes. Who knows? Maybe it's just the fact that I looked like a jerk off when I was over in another country. I expect more out of you all. I know the majority of you listening already, you know, to a certain amount of you, it's like preaching to the choir. But there's others that will hear this. And some people probably get all pissed off at me and tell me I have an attitude or I'm being a self-righteous prick. I don't care, okay? I don't care what your opinion is of me, okay? I'm making you look in the freaking mirror. This is ridiculous. Now you got black teenagers running around, you know, hammering Bosnians in the head with hammers out in St. Louis. The media and the government's responsible for that. Yes, the kids that did it are responsible too. Well, they're little black thugs. No, now see, that's the friggin' mentality that continues this cycle. Because what they do is they get one group to look at the other group as the problem. Doesn't matter what side it is. And then you'll get these white conservatives that go, well, you know, it's okay to bring in the police state like that. Because, you know, look at these black people, they're rioting and they're all crazy. Oh, isn't that convenient, by the way, that they're setting this whole thing up, right? Where it's conservative versus Democrat, black versus white, right? And it kind of looks like it's white conservatives versus black Democrats almost. Isn't that convenient that they're, you know, now that the Democrats have pissed everybody off, the conservatives are going to come back into power? And the conservatives who are at this very moment pissed off with Obama for the quote-unquote police state will be embracing it in 2016 when Jeb Bush is put up as the president. And he gets, and then, you know, they select him and he gets put in. then they'll be embracing the very police state that 2.5 years before they were decrying when Obama was in charge. You see how the frigging game is being played over and over and over again? It's like when George Bush was in office, and I would tell you people on air, or I would write articles, and everybody else was talking about this in the alternative media, and said, look, the Republicans have pissed everybody off. They're going to put in a Democrat, and that'll calm everybody down. That nobody will pay attention to 9/11 because, lo and behold, many people that were protesting Bush were Democrats. And what happened when Obama got in? 9/11 truth started to go away. A lot of the protests started to go away. Oh, look, a pressure relief valve. And then over the course of 8 years, it builds up again. Now they'll throw the Democrat out, and they bring the Republican back in. How many times can we play the same freaking game, ladies and gentlemen? How many times? How many of you are going to go on Facebook and be like, this is bullshit, and then you're going to go vote for these people? Seriously. You want me to talk to you straight? You want me to coddle you? This is absolutely ridiculous. It's a freaking game that they play. It's a game. They're controlled. I called it over a year and a half ago. Go look in my archives. I've had Aaron and Melissa, Aaron Dykes and Melissa Melton, True Stream Media. You know, they do a show here on Truth Frequency. They have a website, YouTube channel. Good friends of mine. Not only did I call it by myself, but I've had them on, I don't know, 100 times to discuss this. And we talked about Jeb Bush versus Hillary Clinton 2016, because that's what I see as they're going to put out there. They might have a Rand Paul or a Ted Cruz as like a side running mate, but it's going to be Jeb Bush, Hillary Clinton 2016. There's a thing in the Washington Examiner today. Jeb Bush is the only person that could beat Hillary Clinton. Oh, God, we got to run him as a Republican ticket. Oh, look, they're setting it up already. This is how the game is played, ladies and gentlemen. Go back and look when they started setting Obama up. It was, you know, a year and a half, 2 years before he ran for president. Maybe he should run for president. People are like, who the hell is this guy? Now he's the greatest president ever. Are you all that stupid? Really? Do you consider yourselves that frigging stupid that you'll go on Facebook and complain about this stuff, and then many of the same people that I see complaining about this stuff and fighting the fight, we're fighting a good fight, Popeye. A lot of you people go out and you start falling for this crap. Well, you don't understand. You know what? Don't give me any of your bullshit excuses. Your emotions are being played. Get a hold of yourselves. I have news for you. It's not just black kids getting shot by cops. It's white people, too. It's everybody. It's not just the cops are racist because they're white. How about the black cop that shot an unarmed white kid? You didn't see any news media over that, did you? Oh, no, you can't talk about that. How about the what was it? I think I saw, I don't remember where the hell it was, the statistic recently. And I'd have to look it up. I think it was 91% of black crime, like people, like black people that are killed, it's by other black people.
It's like 9% of white racist cops.
Yes, there are racist assholes out there. Let's be honest, there is. Because unfortunately, that retarded ideology is still accepted by some people because that's where humanity's at right now, base level of thinking. Hence why I do this radio show, trying to get you to think a little bit. But it's nowhere as bad as they make it out to be. They're doing it because they want a civil war, okay? Because it's the only outcome they can control. They can't control if everybody got together and went, you know what? This is bullshit. They're screwing all of us, and they're playing us all off against each other. It's like if you're in a group of friends, okay? And there's like six or seven of you, and there's that one shit stirrer in the group that goes around behind everybody's back, poking people. Oh, this, you know, Bobby said this about you. Yo, Tim, you know, he said this about you. John, he said this about you. You know, blah, blah, and you're playing. It's just one person playing everybody against each other. It's a simple game, ladies and gentlemen. It's not some, oh, it's a convoluted conspiracy, Popeye, and I can't deal with it. People, you can watch football and know the friggin' statistics of every player, his blood type, and the color underwear the guy wears, because and what superstitions he has, but you can't tell me you can't take 5 minutes to learn this stuff and pay attention? Maybe educate yourself a little bit? Do you like where this country's headed? Because I don't. This isn't the country I grew up in. The country I grew up in had more respect. And we weren't perfect back then, but we certainly weren't this far down the crapper. This is absolutely ridiculous. I'm ashamed. I'm actually ashamed. You know, when I was over in Amsterdam, there was a part of me that didn't want to come back. I didn't. I could, unbeknownst to many people, it wouldn't be very hard to sell everything I own over the course of time and find a place over there. It can be done if you put your mind to it. Anybody could do anything. You'd be amazed what you can accomplish once you put your mind to it. Trust me. I could stay over there if I wanted to. I could actually get Dutch citizenship because my mother was a Dutch citizen, as were my grandparents. So I could get Dutch citizenship if I wanted to, or I could at least attempt to. But I love my country. I was born here. I came back, you know. Obviously, I wasn't running out of the country. But my point is, while I was sitting there, I was tempted. There was a part of me that was tempted to stay there. And why? Because I'm just so tired of the crap here. But you know what? Even though I'm tired of it, and I'm really getting tired of all the apathetic jerk-offs that are still sitting around, or the people that aren't apathetic, that are awake, but then they fall right back into the same traps over and over again. Look, once or twice in the beginning was one thing. Now it's getting to piss me off. Whether you like hearing that or anything, and I, you know, it doesn't matter. You could say, well, I don't care if it pisses you off. That's fine. That's, again, that's just, it's just my opinion that it, but you know what? I'm going to let everybody else know, and I'm going to point it out, and maybe it'll piss them off too. And maybe something will get done then. A lot of smart people out there fall for the same crap over and over and over again. People, this race baiting crap is garbage. It's absolute garbage. How many times have I told you my wife was Puerto Rican? I'm, I guess, what you would consider a white guy, even though I'm kind of a mutt. Did her and I ever have arguments over race? No. Not once. Not in the 9 years I was with her. The best man at my wedding, one of my best friends, is a black guy with dreads that go halfway down his back. We get into conversations about this stuff going on, and he disagrees with a lot of crap. He sees, he says the media, he text messaged me, he said the media is trying to start damn riots. He saw it. He saw through it. Do you think him and I get in fights? And he's like, you honky. Blah, blah. I mean, wait, we might bust each other's balls, but do you think we actually get in fights and hate each other because he's black and I'm white? We look past that. He's like my brother. I'd die for that guy. He's like my family. You think I'd give a shit if he's got black skin? People, your skin color, how we look, where you know, yes, I know people can try to argue and say, oh, there's differences. That's what makes everybody different, you know, and we're not collective. Yes, everybody has individual characteristics, but at the base level, we're all freaking human beings. Let's start there. See, the problem is, a lot of people, and I've said this before, a lot of people don't have the basics, right? Because the basics have been removed by the powers that shouldn't be over the course of time through programming and TV and media and education and all this other crap. So they remove the basics. And once you remove the basics, the foundation, the house comes down. And that's what they're doing. So let's go back to basics. How about we start treating each other as human beings? It doesn't matter if you're black, white, red, purple with yellow polka dots on the outside. You're a human frigging being, okay? Doesn't matter if you're from China, if you're from the Middle East, if you're from Canada, if you're from Europe, if you're from America, Mexico, South America, wherever, Antarctica. If you're a human being, we all function the same way. We might look different on the outside, kind of like cars. And yes, you have, I know some. There's going to be someone out there who goes, well, you know, you have the rotary engine, Popeye, instead of the regular. I get it. But the point is, combustion, compression ignition for diesel, right? All diesels at a base level operate off the same principle. Combustion engines operate off the same principle. So the car, the mechanics of the car pretty much operate the same. Some of them have their own slight characteristics. Maybe one's got some super badass, you know, posi traction for the older guys. You know, got a posi rear, whatever. Maybe you got like, you know, some friggin' Lamborghini that hugs the road. Whatever. Maybe you got a piece of crap Dodge pickup truck from the 1960s. The point is, they all operate mechanically pretty much basically the same. But on the outside, they look different. And they all might have a little slight differences here and there, but they're all vehicles. That's what our bodies are. They're vessels for our soul, the essence that's in us. This isn't, oh, now Popeye's getting all high holy roller. No, it's real simple. It doesn't matter what you believe in religious-wise. You have a soul. You have an essence inside of you. I mean, that's basic common sense by this point with humanity. I don't think humans have souls. Well, too bad for you, okay? You're in, like, the minutia. If you think you're just a meat sack with nothing inside you, sorry for you. You really must live a horrible life. This body's just a vessel for that essence, that soul to ride in, okay? That's all it is. We're here to experience. And yet we don't want to get out of kindergarten, because that's where we're at right now. Humanity as a whole is in kindergarten. And if you narrow it down, if you look at a country like America, if you just look at America itself, dude, we really are. If you look like humanity, like I always say, Earth is like, you know, the kindergarteners of the universe. Well, right now, America is being pushed back in that direction ourselves on the planet. That's why we're being dumbed down. We used to be looked up to as the smartest people. I'm not trying to put America out there like it was the greatest country, but I'm saying there was a time that people would be like flocking to this country to come learn and all this other crap. And I know that you get, well, what about all the illegal immigrants? Put all that stuff aside. I'm saying there used to be a time when people came to this country because they respected. Smart scientists came from America. Engineers came from America. They built things in America. Now, we don't do that. This country has lost everything that was great about it. Next segment, when we come back, because the break's coming up in about 5 minutes, when we come back, wait, I'm going to get into the torture thing. This country has lost its way so bad that like 60% of the people in this country are okay with torture. That's how bad we've lost our way. We don't torture. Yes, we do, Popeye. We're like Jack Bauer, bro. We're America. We're badasses. America, F yeah. Do me a favor, please. Leave the country. Go somewhere else. Go form your own country of douchebagistan and go live in it and run it and have your own little douchebagistan army, okay? Because people like you need to get the hell out. Because you're what's poisoning this country. No, man, you got to torture sometimes to get... you know, I'll get into it. I'll get into it on the other side. Because I'll just keep going, okay? I need enough time to get into it. Just go pack your stuff and go to douchebagistan because that's where you belong. If you agree with torture, I'll get into that further on the other side. Anyway, this whole racial thing, and I've been calling this, and you know what? I feel kind of bad because I've been dealing with all this, and you know, it's like in you know, it's like the worst possible time. You know, I have the you know the ground lifted out from underneath me, right? The rug pulled out from underneath me, and I lose my best friend in the world, right? And I feel kind of bad because I see all this stuff going on. And I actually wasn't even going to come on tonight. Like I said, I'm still worn out from the trip, and I got sick as a dog when I came home for like 8-10 hours. It was horrific, right? But I knew I had to come on tonight because I feel like I'm not pulling my weight. I'm not doing my duty to talk to you guys about this because I keep seeing, and maybe, you know, I'm not saying if I had gone on air, it would have stopped it, but I keep seeing people that I know that, like, I expect more out of saying, making stupid comments are starting to slip down that slope, and I'm like, no, you know, maybe if I go on in there and they hear me, you know, maybe it'll at least spark a little bit of a thought in their mind, and who knows, maybe it won't, maybe I won't change anybody's mind, but I knew I had to come on and talk about this stuff tonight. I love this country. I absolutely love this country. I hate my government. They suck. And the people, and it's actually not the government. It's the people in charge of it. The government's just a tool. I don't really hate the government. I hate the scumbags that are operating the levers of it. Maybe it's time we took down some of the machinations of it because it's so big. We don't need something that huge. We just need some sort of structure and guideline to follow, like a road, right? But you don't need an overdone, just bulky, giant piece of garbage that can't even get out of its own way, because that's about what our government is at right now. Okay? And I got another hour and a half to go off. Look, to finish up, because we got about a minute and a half for the break comes up, to finish up with the race thing, people, please. Please, and I'll be touching on this more when I get into the torture, because racism comes into the whole torture thing there too. But please use your brains. When you're watching this stuff on TV, you know what? First of all, you shouldn't turn the stuff on TV as much and absorb it as much as you are. I hate to tell you, and if you do, then you got to go outside and get the equal amount of positivity. Because what they're doing is they're amping up everybody's emotions, they're getting everybody afraid, and they're trying to get the white people afraid of the black people who are going to riot. And then they're going to piss the black people off and have them riot. It's that simple, okay? It's that they want to play a game. Go back and look. I've talked about this on air. It's in my archives before. Go back in the archives. Look up probably within at least the past year and a half. I'll have to play it again. Actually, I'm going to have to because it's appropriate. But look up in the archives from this year or last year, especially Mae Brussel, and it's in the DTRH archives, but I played it on air. Look up the King Alfred plan. Look up the episode where I talked about the King. You'll see it. It says the King Alfred plan. I think it says MLK and the King Alfred plan or something like that. Anyway, look it up. It was this. Mae Brussel talked about it, and it came from this book called, I think it was The Man Who Cried I Am, was the title of the book. Anyway, it was supposedly fictitious, but not fictitious. And this plan, the King Alfred plan, is like martial law roundup of black people when they have race riots. And they have, like, 10 FEMA centers and everything. Oh, it's really interesting. I've talked about it on air. It's a game, ladies and gentlemen. It's a setup. Don't fall for it. Do not fall for it. We'll be right back. So, Melissa shared a video the other day. I don't know if they recorded or somebody else put it up on YouTube, but it was a video about callers to C-SPAN about the torture memo thing that just came out. And they're all, well, it's a good thing that we tortured. You know, we got actionable intelligence and blah, 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 and we saved American lives and blah, 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 blah. And it's like either they were really just planted calls, or Americans are that stupid. And unfortunately, right now, Americans are that stupid when it comes to torture. People are going to get mad at me. You called me stupid, Popeye. Well, unfortunately, you're being stupid. Okay? Torture has never, not ever, ever in the history of ever gotten actionable intelligence. This has already been determined. See, the point of arguing semantics over the very basics, again, is to get them to skewer and blur the lines. That way, you lose your basics, your ethical values. Well, then it's on. Now, a couple years ago, I've talked about torture and stuff, but a couple years ago, probably about a year and a half, 2 years ago, I think I aired the audio from the movie Standard Operating Procedure. If you haven't seen it, I think you can find it on Netflix. I think it's still there. It might not be for instant viewing, but if you have the DVD package, you might be able to get the DVD thing, or you could probably find it on YouTube or one of these streaming sites. Look up Standard Operating Procedure and another movie that documentary that HBO did, but I think Standard Operating Procedure is actually the better of the two. It came out from Sony Pictures, but out of the two, I think it's the better. And the other one was Ghosts of Abu Ghraib. I want you to go watch those films. They're documentaries. We were doing torture back in 2003. And it was being decried by people. And yet, people would call you unpatriotic, or they'd call you a hippie, or a leftist, or an idiot. Now, I'm not a leftist. I'm not a liberal, right? I'm not a Democrat, but I don't agree that torture is correct, and I know that it doesn't get any actionable quality intelligence. If you're waterboarding me 150 times, they're going to reach a point where my brain is like, I'll tell them whatever they want to know. Yeah, Mickey Mouse, Osama bin Laden, and Spider-Man are teaming up with the Fantastic Four, and they're all going to take over the world. Their headquarters are at, 123, Happy Street, whatever the hell they want to know. You're not going to get any real intelligence. Of course, this war isn't meant to be won. It's just meant to be sustained. Quite like the Vietnam War. Remember what Nick Rockefeller told Aaron Russo about 9-10 months before 9/11. He said that they were going to have soldiers running. He was laughing when he said it. He said they were going to have soldiers running around through caves, chasing people that didn't exist. Remember that little convo? If you don't know what I'm talking about, go look it up. In fact, I could actually try to find it while I'm talking to you, but there's so many different versions of the audio. I don't know which one is the cleanest, but I'll try to find on YouTube the audio while I'm chatting, and then I'll play it. It's a game, okay? And they need to blur the lines when it comes to torture, because then, remember, there's going to come a point when you're going to have quote-unquote, and this was called out. We said this back in 2003, 2004. Back then, I was still an idiot. I didn't really wake up to what was going on with this stuff until about 2005. But that was because, and I realized at the time, it was because of my personal emotional impact from what I experienced on 9/11, right? You know, I helped out with the Red Cross. I was down at Giant Stadium that day with my gear and the local fire departments. I mean, local. We had people from all over the freaking East Coast there. It was amazing. You know, waiting to transport people. It was crazy. Anyway, the point is, I told you we were sitting in the communications tent when they arrested the van load of Israelis on the George Washington Bridge with a van full of explosives. Anyway. When I started to realize what was going on, and I started to look into things, and I started to realize, you know, this isn't us. This isn't how we should be behaving. We should not be behaving this way or acting this way. This isn't America. We're starting to go against our core values, because I started to realize what we were doing. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, you put them in a room, you put their hands behind their back, they're sitting in a chair, you shine a light in their eyes, you might smack them in the face a couple times, like, you know, well, they torture us if we're over in their country, so we do it to their people, that makes it right. One side's supposed to have the moral superiority, putz, and if you're supposedly trying to follow treaties and you don't want your people to be tortured if they're captured, you shouldn't torture the other side's people. Just saying. They did things like take these people's children, suspected insurgent leaders. Even if their father wasn't an insurgent leader, or if they were, they would kidnap their kid. They talk about this in standard operating procedure. They would kidnap the kid, grab the kid, take the kid, and then torture the child until the father turned himself in. You know how many people I know that are okay with that? Well, Popeye, you know, if it stops another 9/11, you're a piece of crap. If you had a kid, would you be okay if the police thought you were an insurgent, a quote-unquote homegrown terrorist, and grabbed your kid off the street and tortured the hell out of your child, including sexually, until you turned yourself in? Would you be okay with that then? Well, no, that's different, but that would never happen because I'm not some rat bastard terrorist in Iraq or Afghanistan or wherever. Oh, okay. What happens when you are labeled a quote-unquote rat bastard terrorist by the same people that are in charge? Well, they would never do that. Well, they already have. So again, what happens when it's your child? Then what? Is it still cool? What about your wife? What about if they sexually abuse your wife in front of you while you're chained to a wall and there's nothing you can do about it? Yeah, America! Makes me sick. They would put ants on children's genitals? Do other things to the children's genitals? Why, first of all, why are you touching children in any way, shape, or form, let alone getting them naked in some weird cell in some prison out in the middle of the desert? Here in America, we call that pedophilia. You'd get arrested and shot for that in certain places. Probably hung up in the public square. But no, when our soldiers do it, it's all good. When you have other government agencies, because that's who did most of it. It wasn't our soldiers. You know, those kids at Abu Ghraib, they got sent away. They were like E5s and below. They didn't know what the hell was going on. And you, when they interviewed them, you see them interviewed in a documentary, they tell you what happened. And you can see it was the OGAs, the other government agencies, the CIA, the FBI, NSA, DHS, and then you have what's OGAs, like civilian contractors and stuff, that can come in, and they're not really accountable to anybody. They don't have to give names, nothing. Those are the people that did most of the torturing and the beatings and the killings and stuff like that. And then they send these young idiots up the river. It's the way it works. But hey, it's okay. We got actionable intelligence, right? We stopped the war on terror, right? Right? America, F yeah. We're much safer, right? I mean, we didn't create more terrorism all over the world, right? We didn't piss off the entire world. We didn't lose face all over the world. We didn't spend billions of dollars and waste thousands and thousands of our own people's lives and millions of people's lives around the world for nothing. And by the way, the same conservatives that all you right-wingers out there, you people that associate yourself with the right wing, because there really isn't a right wing or a left wing. It's all bullshit, okay? But some of you still associate yourselves with that. So just as a reminder to those of you that associate yourselves with the right wing, the entire slew of right-wing douchebags that are out there right now, okay, Rand Paul, he sucks up to the people that are responsible. He's not responsible, but he's currently sucking up to the group that is responsible for what I'm about to tell you, okay? Marco Rubio, all them. When you hear Rubio, oh, I have an idea for a new American century. Really? Really? You know, I heard that once before. It was 99... Project for 2000, 99 or 2000. Project for a New American Century, think tank. Oh, Jeb Bush was a member. Oh, look at that. Oh, Paul Wolfowitz. Oh, Henry Kissinger. Oh, wow. Wow. Which I'm sure it's just a coincidence. Even though in this white paper called Rebuilding America's Defenses, they called for complete overhaul of the U.S. military from what it was to what it is now, which is what you see. And a change in the way we fight wars and the way we actually, you know, more wars of what did they call it? What the hell did they call it? It was preemptive war. That's what it was. Preemptive war. Meaning, you know, like we did with Iraq. Well, he hasn't attacked us, but he could. And that's like me saying, well, my neighbor might be a dick to me one day, so I'm just going to go over and burn his house down. I mean, that's basically what we did, right? So in this paper, Rebuilding America's Defenses, it says that they have this whole plan. They want to redo the military. They want to, you know, go into these countries and take over and blah, 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 and spread democracy through the Middle East and all sort of crap. But they said that America would not do this. Americans themselves would not be down with doing this. So it would be a very slow, very non-fast moving, slow turtle-like pace, and that doesn't suit them. They said the only way they can get beyond that bit of a speed bump, and I quote, it is a new catalyzing event, or a catalyzing event, I should say, such as a, quote, new Pearl Harbor. Now, what did George Bush call his diary? What did he call 9/11 in his diary? He said, this is this generation's Pearl Harbor. Very interesting quote, George. Very interesting quote indeed, considering your brother was involved in a think tank and half of your administration was involved in a think tank that just a year and a half before, had put out a white paper saying that the very thing that they're doing now could not be accomplished without a 9/11-style event. And then 9/11 happens. But I'm the conspiracy theorist because I can connect the dots and I can see how it goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's not that hard, ladies and gentlemen. What's hard is for you to accept it because that would blow your whole mind. That would mean, oh my God, they did it. Well, they did, okay? And this same group, I'm not saying that Obama and his crew are any different. It's like two heads of the, you know, the business card, the logo, Federal Jack. It's got Uncle Jack and he's got the two puppets. And it's, you know, he's the shady, you know, Illuminati, you know, Uncle Sam character, but he's got the right and the left. They're both puppets. That's what that is. Okay. They're controlled by the same people. But the wing that brought you 9/11, these scumbags that brought you 9/11 itself, are now wrangling their way back, and they're like, yeah, we're for conservative values. And there's so many people that are just like, yeah, they're going to save us because the Democrats are dicks. These are the same people that literally, what was that, John, it's not John Woo, I can't remember his name, John something or something, I can't remember his name, the friggin' attorney that rewrote the torture laws under the Bush administration. Ah, it's okay to torture, like reworded things. I mean, it's illegal, but they had to go in and change everything to reword. Eh, but it's okay. Look, we have to do this. It's for the war on terror. So again, I ask you, what happens when it's not brown Arab people? Because see, that's where the racism part comes in. Because they get you to – what they do to the military, they've done to the civilians too. Okay, it's propaganda. They dehumanize the enemy in your eyes. It's what how they train the military to shoot at another human being. Because, you know, World War II, interesting fact, I think it was – 3 out of 10 Marines that would shoot, you know, in a battle that were in a firefight, it was 3 out of 10 were actually aiming, and the rest were either, you know, shooting to the side, shooting up, shooting down, and it was because they had been trained to shoot at round targets, not silhouettes. So when they saw another human being, it freaked them out mentally, and they wouldn't shoot. Why do you think they've adjusted the training? Hey, now they have targets that look like average everyday citizens holding one. The targets, what were they, like 6 months ago? It was a big thing where they came out and it was like average citizens with just guns. And it was like a mother holding a baby and she had a gun and these were the targets that cops were training with and DHS was training with. I forget, there was a special name they had for them. It got out there and it got all hushed hush, but it wouldn't surprise me if they were still using them. You just don't know about it. And a lot of people were like, oh, they talked about it. It was exposed. They're not using that anymore. Really? Really, it's that simple? Because they talked about it for 15 minutes, you know, they say, we won't use them, we promise. We're going to destroy them. It was a mistake. And everybody goes, okay, don't you do that again. And then they turn their backs and they're like, okay, go ahead and use them. That's how that works. I mean, come on, ladies and gentlemen. Really? You got to stay on them. You got to expose this more. You got to talk about this stuff. So anyway, because they know that it's not normal for another human to want to kill another human being, do cruel things to them, they have to, A, search out for the people that want to do that to other humans. B, they know that they're not going to get everybody to be a sociopath, so they have to program you to go in that direction. They have to lead you down that road. And then why do you think people come back? Young guys come back from what they've seen or maybe what they've been forced to do because they were put in a situation where it was them or the 15-year-old kid that was holding the AK-47 at them. And I got to tell you what, I don't care if it's an 11 or a 15, and I know a lot of my listeners have kids, but I got to tell you, if I'm in the middle of a firefight somewhere and there's an 11-year-old kid holding an AK-47 at me, I'm going to kill him. Okay? If it's me or the kid with the AK-47, I'm not going to go, well, he's 11 years old. He's going to shoot you. He doesn't care. But the problem is when you come home, you have to deal with that. Maybe you have an 11-year-old kid. And now you see that little boy's face with the AK-47 in your son's eyes. And the guy goes in his bedroom and puts a 45 into his mouth. Because it's not natural to want to torture and kill and do things. They have to program and engineer us. They have to dehumanize the enemy. That's how they do it with soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines. They do the same thing with the general public. They get you to hate the other side. Why do you think that they have students being taught in kindergarten and in first grade, and you can go back and look this up, this is a couple years ago, that they were teaching kids that the reason why we're in the war in Afghanistan, and I mean, I literally heard the teacher say this, well, we're in Afghanistan, and she was telling those students, because the people in Afghanistan want to come here and kill all of us. So we have to go over there and kill them where they are so they don't come here and kill us. The people of Afghanistan want to kill us. This is what they're teaching the kids. Not a small group that resides in Afghanistan. The people of. That instantly, that sentence, especially in a young child's mind, you're forming the foundation that the people in Afghanistan, all of them, it doesn't matter who they are all lower than Americans. They're bad. They want to hurt you. So we have to go over there and kill them, or they're going to come get you. You've just dehumanized those people and made them the enemy. It's all psychological. It's all psychological warfare. That's how it's played. Look, Warfare 101, besides the you know, you have like snipers and some of the technology and all that, warfare really hasn't changed too much with one side wanting to kill the other, okay? You might have a few things here with technology and bombs, missiles, rockets, and all that. But honestly, the mastery of it all is the psychological warfare, because that's how you get the other side to give in. That's how you get your own men to go out and kill and do things that they should never be doing. I played a couple months ago. It's on YouTube. Go look it up. Go look at my archives. And I've got it up there. I got it rendered and it's all up. The show I did about the Vietnam secrets, whatever the hell I titled it, was Vietnam war crimes from Vietnam, or Vietnam war crimes exposed, or whatever the hell it was. It was like 2 months ago. It's in my archive. Go look it up. It's on YouTube. It's one of the most recent YouTube videos in the DTRH Radio Archives YouTube channel. You heard these guys, and this is from 1972, Winter Soldier hearings. You heard these guys talking about how they were in the back of helicopters, and when they would get load the prisoners onto a helicopter, they were told, don't count the prisoners until you land, because there's going to be a disparity between when you take off and when you land. And they didn't understand how that was possible until they watched what they did. They were interrogating some of them, and their method of interrogation was they would take wire, and they talked about this. These were the guys that were there. This is not me making this up. They took the wire, they wrapped it around their head, over their eyes, pulled it tightly so it went into their eyes, okay? And then they bound their hands behind their back and their, you know, sometimes their feet, and they would stand them up, and they would open the back of the helicopter, you know, slide open the side door, or if they were, you know, in a plane, whatever, drop the back open, and if the guy, they would ask the guy, blah, 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 do you know something, blah, 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 blah. If he didn't answer in time or didn't give enough answer, maybe he didn't even understand English, so he didn't know what he was being asked, he got tossed out of the plane with his hands bound behind him and wire bound over his eyes. Well, he's just a VC gook, Popeye Proud. We killed an American soldier. Do you even know the history of the Vietnam War? If you don't know that we were in Vietnam back in the late 40s, then shut up. And don't talk to me. Go back and do your research first. Don't run your mouth acting like you think you know what you're talking about. It's not okay that they threw people out of helicopters and out of planes. I don't give a shit what justification you try to find for it. It's not okay. The people that should be tossed out of airplanes are the people that abuse children that are in high positions of power. The very people that killed Nancy Schaefer. Go look her up. These elitist scumbags that are connected to all these higher-ranking groups. You catch them, you know, these kid killers. You know what I'm talking about. Those people should be thrown out of a friggin' airplane, okay? If anybody. Here you have someone that's bound and gagged. You don't know if this, maybe the guy, how do you know what his motivation was for fighting you? Well, he's VC, he's a commie. It wasn't that simple, and you ought to know better than that. That's not okay. Again, what happens when you're the insurgent? Well, that'll never happen. It's happening right now, genius. So what happens if this country continues down the slide that it's going down? And what happens when you become a homegrown insurgent or extremist? Then what? Is torture okay on you and your children? Is it okay to sexually abuse your child? I'll ask you that again. Is it okay if your child is sexually abused and tortured in order to lure you out if the authorities think you're a threat in some way, shape, or form? Is that okay? Would it be okay for an American cop if a detective thought you were guilty of a crime? And they were pretty damn sure. Their intelligence said that you were guilty of the crime. But they, for some reason, they just couldn't get you. So would it be okay instead of the SWAT team coming to your house or the detective, you know, getting you, they come to your house and grab your kid or grab your kid off the street, which is kidnapping, okay, and then take that kid to some detention center and torture the crap out of him? Is that okay? And again, including sexual abuse. Is that okay? If you tell me it is, you're a scumbag. And if you tell me, well, it's not okay with my kid, but it's okay with an Arab kid, you're a scumbag. Why is it okay with the Arab kid? Because they're brown and they're in the Middle East? That's the dehumanization that's been fed to you. That's not normal. That's not normal. You've been programmed like a friggin' computer. And you know what? The beauty of it is you can be reprogrammed to see things as they are. Or have that programming removed. I don't even like the word reprogrammed because I wouldn't want you to think a certain way. I wouldn't want to change the way. I want to change the way you think, as in I want you to actually use your brains instead of allowing someone else to do the thinking for you. But I would never program your brains to think the way I wanted you to think. I just want you to think on your own. You'll see the reality once you start to think on your own. It's that plain and simple. It's right in your face. I don't have to force feed it to you. So maybe I shouldn't use the word reprogramming. How about just deprogramming? Getting rid of all that bad code. And letting your operating system reboot. These people that control things, the people I call the powers that shouldn't be, okay, they're very smart. They know what they're doing. They know how to manipulate humanity. They're very good at what they do, ladies and gentlemen, okay? You should really question yourself if you think torture is okay. I really, really expect you to question yourself. If you think torture is okay, you need to check yourself. To quote Ice Cube, you need to chiggity check yourself before you riggity wreck yourself, okay? For real. Put yourself in the person who's being tortured shoes. Or like I said, if it was their children and you have children, think about what you would do if someone tortured your child. I'm pretty sure most of you out there would want to do very horrible things to the person who tortured your child very slowly and over the course of a period of time. Okay? So now put yourself in a position of the shoes of some of these people over in the Middle East or these other countries wherever we've done torture. Rendition them to. Would you be cool? Would you be cool? Would you not want to maybe inflict harm and anger? You don't think maybe the people that pull the strings at the very top that are playing the whole game of chess, you don't think they understand that? Ooh. You think they're really as dumb as they act as they are? You know, if I'm the government, right, and I act dumb and like I'm a bumbling idiot, you expect less of me. Yeah, the government, they can't do anything. Idiots, they're always screwing things up. Then they can do whatever they want because no one's paying attention. This is Sparta! It's time to wake up. Break sneaking up. We'll be back in 3 short minutes. Police brutality, my next subject. Interesting comparison for you. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Don't allow them to get you to give away humanity. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number 2 here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. It is December 10th, 2014, and I am on a friggin' roll tonight, am I not? So, before I get into the subject of police brutality, because I could spend hours on that, I have some interesting comparisons to make. But before I get into that subject, I want to play the audio that I promised you. I did say that I would try to find it while I was talking, but I got so sidetracked I realized I had about 2 minutes left. So I finished up. I figured I would finish, and during the break, I found the audio on one of my hard drives because I have this stuff all over the place. Remember, if I play it, I'm probably ripping the video as I'm playing it for you, or I have 1,000... you know, different copies of it somewhere on multiple hard drives. Back up everything on the internet. Anyway, I did promise you that I would let you hear this piece of audio. And this is Aaron Russo being interviewed by Peter Joseph. This is from the first Zeitgeist film. Now, I don't care what you think. I don't particularly believe what they believe in with the Zeitgeist movement. You know, they want to have robots rule things. No, that's, you know, really? Terminator? Skynet? Any questions? How many science fiction novels do you have to read? You know, Philip K. Dick, go read any of his stuff. Any of these greats, you know. You want to turn it into a dystopian police state with friggin' robots running things? Anyway. The first film, they were exposing 9/11, and there's a section of the film where they're talking about 9/11, and then after that about the New World Order, the whole agenda, and he's talking to Aaron Russo, filmmaker and activist, and he also used to be Bette Midler's manager. He's responsible for The Rose, you know, the album The Rose, her, you know, the tour, all that stuff. Aaron's very famous guy. He also passed away, but he's the one that handed the reins from RTR to Gary Franchi, good friend of mine. Gary's a great guy. So he was being interviewed by Peter Joseph for the film, and he talks about what I said about his conversation with Nick Rockefeller and what Nick Rockefeller told him about the whole agenda. So I want to play this for you really quick, and then I'll get into the police brutality thing. But I did promise that I would play this for you, so let me cue this up for you first, and then we'll get to the police brutality. Trust me, I got plenty of time. So here we go. Nick Rockefeller and Aaron Russo.
And if we have learned anything from history, it is that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. This is Aaron Russo, a filmmaker and former politician. To his left is Nicholas Rockefeller of the infamous Rockefeller Banking and Business Dynasty. After maintaining a close friendship with Nicholas Rockefeller, Aaron eventually ended the relationship, appalled by what he had learned about the Rockefellers and their ambitions.
I got a call one day from an attorney woman I knew, and she said, "Would you like to meet one of the Rockefellers?" I said, "Sure, I'd love to." And we became friends, and he began to divulge a lot of things to me. So he said to me one night, he said that there's going to be an event there, and out of that event, you're going to see we're going to go into Afghanistan, so we run pipelines from the Caspian Sea. We're going to go into Iraq to take the oil and establish a base in the Middle East, and we're going to go into Venezuela and try and get rid of Chavez. And the first two they've accomplished, Chavez they didn't accomplish. And I said, you're going to see guys going into caves looking for looking for people that they're never going to find. You know, he was laughing about the fact that you have this war on terror. There's no real enemy. He's talking about how by having this war on terror, you can never win it because it's an eternal war. And so you can always keep taking people's liberties away. And I said, how are you going to convince people that this war is real? He said, but the media. The media can convince everybody it's real. I mean, you know, it's just that you keep talking about things. You keep saying it over and over and over again, and eventually people believe it. You know, you created the Federal Reserve in 1913 through lies. You create 9/11, which is another lie. Through 9/11, you're fighting a war on terror, and now all of a sudden you go into Iraq, which was another lie, and now they're going to do Iran. You know, and it's all one thing leading to another, leading to another, leading to another. Now, I would say to him, what are you doing this for? What's the point of this thing? You have all the money in the world you ever want. You have all the power. I said, you know, you're hurting people. It's not a good thing. And he would say, what do you care about the people for? Take care of yourself and you take care of your family. And then I said to him, what are the ultimate goals here? He said, the ultimate goal is to get everybody in this world chipped with the RFID chip and have all money be on those chips and everything on those chips. And if anybody wants to protest what we do or violate what we want, we just turn off the chip.
That's right, microchipped.
So, if you're a bad citizen, they can just turn off your chip. I could get into that and spend hours on that. My point is, there's the audio. So you heard him say they'd be running around in caves chasing people that don't exist. Anyway, moving on, police brutality. So, what's the interesting comparison I have for you? Well, for those of you who have never been to Amsterdam, I could tell you that that city is a mixture of four cities. It's a mixture of Los Angeles, Miami, New York, which, by the way, was modeled after Amsterdam. It was originally called New Amsterdam. History that you don't know because people don't pay attention or it's not in your history book because they're too busy teaching you Common Core bullshit. Anyway, New York was modeled after Amsterdam. But Amsterdam is like New York. Miami, Los Angeles, and Vegas all rolled into one. It's a city that's hundreds of years old, and it is still very much a port city. And just like it was a port city back in the day, that's why prostitution is legal there. That's why you have, it's just like a port city back then, except you don't have a lot of, you know, maybe people, everything ranging from pirates to, you know, people transporting cargo or the military, whatever. Now you have a lot of tourism. I mean, you still have ships and stuff coming in too, but you have a lot of tourism coming in. So that's, it's, but it's still a port city. It's still got that feel to it, but it's like a gateway for the world, because there are people, I mean, the Europeans can travel to Amsterdam for the weekend. These guys from the UK, they came over, I think they said they paid like £60 or £70 to fly over, which I don't know what that equates to in US dollars, but they said it wasn't much. I don't know what that would be in euros, but still, it costs an American $1,200 to fly to Amsterdam. It costs them, you know, £90. What is that? $120 maybe? $100? I don't know what the exchange rate is, but I mean, really? So they can fly over there. So it's a lot of Europeans go over there, and then you have people traveling from all over the world over there. So although you do get a lot of world travelers to the four cities I named in America, it's like taking all four of those cities and combine them into one city. I mean, that's the amount of foot traffic and people going through. It's amazing. It's like a mini New York City, Amsterdam. Well, I shouldn't say mini New York City. It's like New York City, but over, you know, in the Netherlands. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. They have legal prostitution. You can walk down the street. They also have brothels you can go to, too. But you can walk down the street in a red light district, and there's girls. Even during the day, there's certain spots in the red light district that at certain there's or they can start earlier in the day than 6 o'clock, because you'll see them out there at like 3 p.m. And they stand in the window and all that. But I mean, the Europeans have a different attitude towards sex. Let's just remember, America was founded by people that were so uptight the British kicked them out. It's a joke. The Puritans. I know people don't. Not many people get it. The point is, we're a little bit uptight. We like to think, man, we're all about sex over here in America. We're really like uptight over here in America. Trust me. So in a city where you have prostitution that's legal, and I can even show you the sign of the picture I took of the sign, they had on a sign that was warning tourists of dangerous cocaine being sold to tourists. It was white heroin that was being sold as cocaine. And the guy must have made a mix-up, because if you understand street values, white heroin is worth way more than cocaine. So the guy was like, I mean, either they were trying to kill people or they were just somebody made a goof-up, okay, which is probably what happened. But they thought they were selling coke, and it was white heroin, and obviously some of the tourists would do a big rail, and it's overdosing, and they would die. So how did the police respond in Amsterdam? Did they go and shut down all the coffee shops and say, it's the pot, it's a gateway drug? Did they go out and beat people to death and shoot them in the streets and run around like the army? Nope. They put up signs, and they put up trailers, you know, illuminating. The big, you know, the yellow ones, the ones that get hacked, and they see like the road hazard ones that they put on the highway where they hack all the time and say there's a zombie invasion. They had them up all over the city, and I have video of it. And it says, warning, you know, white heroin being sold to tourists as cocaine. For more information, go to, you know, whatever the website is. And then on the sign, there's more information on the sign. And in big letters on the sign, it says, you will not be arrested for doing illegal drugs in Amsterdam. Or for using drugs in Amsterdam. I don't know if it said illegal in there or not. I have to look at the picture. I don't remember. But it said, you will not be arrested for using drugs in Amsterdam. I didn't see the cops running around batoning the crap out of people. There were arguments. I witnessed a fight. And it was actually because you know, being here in America, sometimes you get involved in stuff or whatever. It was the weirdest thing. I was so weirded out. I was telling Joe this earlier. I actually stood back and put my hands in my pocket. I watched these two guys get in a fight, and everybody in the street, as soon as they were letting it go to a certain level, and when it started to get where they started to throw blows, everybody in the street mobbed in, ran over, and separated the two of them. And then tried to keep the situation calmed down. It was amazing. Absolutely amazing. Did the cops run over and shoot them both and kill them both in the street? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Did I see instances where there were the cops had to come in and talk to somebody? Maybe they're getting a little too rowdy or whatever? Yeah, sure. It's Amsterdam. You want to talk about rowdy? It's Amsterdam. Okay? But did the cops come up with a club and beat the crap out of them? Nope. Were they walking around with riot gear on? Nope. Yeah, they did have BDU-style pants, and I totally wear BDU-style pants every day. I get it because they're functional. They have multiple pockets. But they were blue. They weren't black. They were like navy blue. And they had the jackets they have on are highly reflective. They don't, you know, they were like orange and white, and I think there was another color in there, but there was blue, might have been yellow. Okay. It wasn't like they were dressed up like Darth Vader and the Stormtroopers. Now, maybe they have that gear somewhere, but they weren't walking around with it on the regular like our cops do. They weren't walking around dressed up like Billy Badass. They were dressed in their uniform, and they conducted themselves professionally. Now, I asked my Dutch friends over there, multiple people, men, women. I said, if someone gets shot here in Amsterdam, is it really a big deal? Do they care? Are people upset? And they said, yeah, it's really a huge deal. It's an absolute huge deal over here in Amsterdam. Not just Amsterdam, but the Netherlands in general. They said, you know, but using the city itself as an example, I said, say a cop shot somebody. I said, do they investigate the cop? Is he taken off service? Oh, yeah, you know, they take him off. They investigate him. I said, now, if he was found that it was not a justified shooting, could he be punished? Oh, yeah, and it would be severe, and the people would want punishment, and it would be a big story, and people would be, you know, it would be such a big thing because it doesn't happen. And yet that city has legalized prostitution, and you can smoke cannabis legally there. You can get certain types of truffles and entheogens or hallucinogens there legally. You can drink. It's a friggin' old city that's hundreds of years old. It's a port city. It's got this huge, huge history. And yet they have their cops walking around acting like professionals. Now, I'm sure there might be an instance once in a while where cops act like dicks over there. No doubt. Nobody's perfect. But I got to tell you what. Every time I've ever been over there, I've always been impressed with the way they conduct themselves. You can walk up to the police there and be like, excuse me, officer, can I ask you something? Yes, can I help you? People have gotten arrested, beaten, and tased, shot here for trying to ask an officer for directions or a question because the officer is having a bad day or whatever. And they decided to take it out on that person. Two totally drastic different worlds. And I don't want to hear, oh, no, you know, the Dutch, they said they're socialists. And I'm not advocating their form of government or 33% tax or anything else. All I'm telling you is, because see, that would be like a straw man argument. Bing, 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 break out your drinks. Logical fallacy, right? No, don't try to come at me with that crap. I'll preempt it right now. Apples and oranges, two different arguments. What I'm saying is they're cops. Behave themselves. And it's funny because one of the people I asked in Amsterdam, well, actually, it wasn't one. It was pretty much all of them said the same thing. But one in particular made this point to me that, you know, their cops, to them, they might complain about it. And they might be like, yeah, our cops are dicks or whatever. But if you compare them to American cops, they're like Rebecca of Sunnybrook Farm, pretty much. And she didn't say that. That's my wording. But Rebecca of Sunnybrook Farm. And I grilled a lot of people about this. I really did grill a lot of people over there about this. Like, I would get in conversation, not grill them, but you know what I mean. I'd get in conversations with them and pick their brains about it. And I kept asking everybody that I met that was from either born and raised in Holland and, you know, lived in Amsterdam or worked in Amsterdam and had been there a while, you know, how they felt about the police there and everything else. And then I would get into conversations about the American police. And they said, yeah, without a shadow of a doubt, that they're like, your cops are just out of control. They just shoot people. I mean, there's people that are afraid to come over here from Europe now because they're like, you know, honestly, there's a lot of Europeans that don't want to go over there anymore. Because we used to have a huge European, like when I lived in Miami, there was a huge European, I don't know what you call it, like just like flow of Europeans, I guess you could say, because they came in 24/7. Certain times of the year it was more heavy, but they were like this huge European base to the tourist industry down there. And over the course of time, a lot of them, now, yeah, Miami, they started bringing the hip-hop festival garbage, and now Memorial Day weekend is just, they turn it into like thug weekend, and then they use it as an excuse to break out the police state stuff, and then they shoot people, and it's just, it's turned into a mess. So between all the idiots that come down, and then the cops acting like complete jagoffs, you know, you have two opposite ends of the spectrum. A lot of the tourists don't want to come anymore because they're just afraid, right? So now a lot of these Europeans don't want to come over here. I had Europeans telling me, I used to go, I noticed one guy who, and this was years ago, this before, you know, this is not even on the Amsterdam trip, but I had a guy tell me, this was his last trip here. We were hanging out in front of the tattoo shop, and I knew him, and he was a regular. He'd come over like twice a year. And he would come over and get tattooed, get a lot of, you know, drop a lot of money, hang out with us. We'd go out drinking. He was a nice guy. It was his last trip here. He said, I don't trust your cops down here in Miami anymore. And I was like, what do you mean? I said, well, you don't do anything illegal. He goes, yeah, but you know what? Over the years, I keep seeing more and more innocent people getting shot in the news and everything else. He goes, I don't want to bring my family here anymore. I'm concerned for their safety. Your police frighten me that much. So, I mean, it's not like we're not known around the world for this, okay? So anyway, while I'm there, I'm seeing this huge drastic difference where their cops are dealing with people. And it's not like you have people, you know, we have people from all over the different place in those cities, Popeye. They have people from all over the world, too. And like I said, it's if you've never been there, you don't know what you're talking about. Because you're literally surrounded by people from all over the world. I mean, I hung out with people from like almost every different country, a lot of Middle Eastern countries. Everybody was chill, hanging out, smoking, talking. Nobody was hating on each other. People might have had their own conceptions, you know, in their head. You know, their own notions that were in their noodles maybe formulated before. I mean, I'm not saying that everybody that came into shops was perfect and awesome and blah, 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 blah. What I'm saying is, the people, even if they were rowdy in the shops and they got rowdy outside, you didn't see them getting the crap picked out of them by the police. And if the cops had to handle a situation, I'm sure there are times that there's violence. I'm sure. But that's not the first go-to thing. It's the last thing that they go to. So what's the difference between our cops and their cops? I mean, we're all humans. It's not like, you know, they raise the, you know, they have the undead walking around in police uniforms. Although that is the mentality, the brain level of some of them, because they hire cops now with an IQ of 100 or less. But what's the difference? Perhaps the training? Perhaps it has something to do with that. It's not perhaps. Of course it has something to do with that. It is the friggin' training. Think about it. The cops nowadays are trained that everybody's out to get them, that there's a terrorist under their pillow. And you better be careful because that terrorist has Ebola-tipped darts. And he hates cops. And he's friends with the sovereign citizen movement and 9/11 truthers. And that they're this thin blue line between scum and what we have is an awesome society and blah, 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 blah. And they program them and they program them and they program them. And they get them all amped up on fear, and then you see how, you know, you see them reacting, how they react. They shoot, again, it's not just black kids. How many times have they shot white women? They shot a woman in a church parking lot because she refused to roll her window down, and they shot and killed her in the head. She was like a white Sunday school teacher or whatever she was, or whatever the hell she did. I think she was a teacher or whatever. But they shot her. Maybe I think it was a church parking lot they shot her in. It's got nothing to do. I mean, yes, there are some cops that are racist idiots, no doubt. But it's got nothing. The police brutality issue, again, this is why they got to make it about race. It also helps them, the powers that shouldn't be, create a civil war. But they got to make it about race because everybody started to realize, hey, wait a minute. Why are they using MRAPs? Why are they dressed up like the military? And they went, oh, shit, they're paying attention. But they understand how this works. So very quickly, they just put out more propaganda. No, it's don't pay attention. It's not the police state. And you can see that the propaganda is working because I saw that there was a college professor. I don't remember where she was, the dean, whatever, I think. She put out I think it was the dean of the college, and she put out a thing the other day and said, hashtag all lives matter, because one of these hashtags is Black Lives Matter. Right? Again, they're getting everybody to like break themselves up into smaller subgroups because they don't want people to realize that it's all of us versus them. The way they control us and the way that they can control things is by keeping everybody separated. So this college professor gets a ration of crap and ends up having to write an apology letter because she wrote that all lives matter. And there were students that emailed her in anger and said, you're diminishing what black people go through by taking away from the hashtag Black Lives Matter. No, what you're doing is you're allowing yourself to be part of that cycle of control, okay? You're allowing yourself to be subjugated into a small group. Well, just black people get shot by cops. No, they don't. Everybody is getting shot by the cops, okay? Everybody. It's not about race. But this professor, or whatever the hell she was, the dean, she had to make an apology letter because in this original email she said all lives matter. And she's right, all lives do matter. Maybe if we looked at things like that, we wouldn't be so quick to shoot each other. Again, it's not just black and white. And yes, there is racist cops and racist idiots out there, without a shadow of a doubt. No doubt. But the police brutality problem isn't a white-on-black problem. It's a police brutality problem. It's a police training problem. We've been talking about this for years. Suddenly, people are paying more attention to it, and then all of a sudden, no, it's not about that. It's a black-white thing. It's got nothing to do with police brutality. Yes, it does. It's all about police brutality. Unfortunately, the media only focuses on when a black child is shot. And I'm not saying that those kids shouldn't, you know, none of these people should get, you know, airtime. But they don't focus on anybody else. So the way it's presented is it looks like only black kids are getting shot. But in reality, that's not what's happening. Everybody's getting shot. Look what they did with Dorner, one of their own cops in L.A. The cops were lighting up everything under the sun. And they shot at like two Mexican women in a truck that didn't even look like his. They were shooting people's vehicles up all over the friggin' place. They didn't care what color you were. I mean, they were shooting at white people that weren't even in a truck. They were in like cars. Clearly didn't look like this guy. But hey, what the hell? It's called police brutality. Don't allow them to hijack this crap. And Al Sharpton, again, two words, Tawana Brawley, ladies and gentlemen. This guy's a career scumbag. That's literally what his job title is. Career scumbag. It's all Al Sharpton is. Jesse, I wiped Martin Luther King Jr.'s blood on me. Jackson is no better. Mr. Counsel on Foreign Relations. By the way, he was the last guy speaking to Martin Luther King Jr. as he was shot in the face. I wonder what he said to him. Pretty interesting to know. Anyway, we will be right back. Stay tuned.
I know you're out there. I can feel you now. I know that you're afraid. You're afraid of us. You're afraid of change. I don't know the future. I didn't come here to tell you how this is going to end. I came here to tell you how it's going to begin. I'm going to show these people what you don't want them to see. I'm going to show them a world without you. A world without rules and controls, without borders or boundaries. A world where anything is possible. Where we go from there is a choice I leave to you.
President John F. Kennedy.
Ladies and gentlemen, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it. Even today, there is little value in opposing the threat of a closed society by imitating its arbitrary restrictions. Even today, there is little value in ensuring the survival of our nation if our traditions do not survive with it. And there is very grave danger that an announced need for increased security will be seized upon by those anxious to expand its meaning to the very limits of official censorship and concealment. That I do not intend to permit to the extent that it's in my control. And no official of my administration, whether his rank is high or low, civilian or military, should interpret my words here tonight as an excuse to censor the news, to stifle dissent, to cover up our mistakes, or to withhold from the press and the public the facts they deserve to know. For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. No president should fear public scrutiny of his program, for from that scrutiny comes understanding, and from that understanding comes support or opposition, and both are necessary. I am not asking your newspapers to support an administration, but I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people. For I have complete confidence. And the response and dedication of our citizens, whenever they are fully informed. I not only could not stifle controversy among your readers, I welcome it. This administration intends to be candid about its errors. For as a wise man once said, an error doesn't become a mistake until you refuse to correct it. We intend to accept full responsibility for our errors, and we expect you to point them out when we miss them. Without debate, without criticism, no administration and no country can succeed, and no republic can survive. That is why the Athenian lawmaker Solon decreed it a crime for any citizen to shrink from controversy. And that is why our press was protected by the First Amendment, the only business in America specifically protected by the Constitution, not primarily to amuse and entertain, not to emphasize the trivial and the sentimental, not to simply give the public what it wants, but to inform, to arouse, to reflect, to state our dangers and our opportunities, to indicate our crises and our choices, to lead, mold, educate, and sometimes even anger public opinion. This means greater coverage and analysis of international news. For it is no longer far away and foreign, but close at hand and local. It means greater attention to improved understanding of the news, as well as improved transmission. And it means, finally, that government at all levels must meet its obligation to provide you with the fullest possible information outside the narrowest limits of national security. And so it is to the printing press, to the recorder of man's deeds, the keeper of his conscience, the courier of his news, that we look for strength and assistance, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent.
Stephen, we heal. As a team, we're going to crumble. Inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. We're in hell right now, gentlemen, believe me. And we can stay here, get the shish kicked out of us, or we can fight our way back, into the light, We can climb out of hell, 1 inch at a time. You know, when you get old in life, things get taken from you. I mean, that's part of life. But you only learn that when you start losing stuff. You find out life's just a game of inches. So is football. Because in either game, life or football, the margin for error is so small. I mean, one half a step too late or too early, and you don't quite make it. One half second too slow, too fast, you don't quite catch it. The inches we need are everywhere around us. They're in every break of the game, every minute, every second. On this team, we fight for that inch. On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch. We claw our fingernails for that inch. Because we know when we add up all those inches, that's going to make the fucking difference between winning. It's the guy who's willing to die who's going to win that itch. And I know if I'm going to have any life anymore, it's because I'm still willing to fight and die for that itch. Because that's what living is. There's 6 inches in front of your face. Now, I can't make you do it. You got to look at the guy next to you. Look into his eyes. Now, I think you're going to see a guy who will go that inch with you. You're going to see a guy who will sacrifice himself for this team because he knows when it comes down to it, you're going to do the same for him. That's the team, gentlemen. And either we heal now as a team, or we will die as individuals.
Ideas. The reason I played that for you all, ladies and gentlemen, is A, I haven't played that for you all in a while, and B, after a night of me ripping on you for an hour and a half, I thought that I could open the final segment with something that I know you all find inspiring every time I play it. Because at the end of the day, I'm not going to just sit here for 2 hours and rip on you and then be like, now go home and suck on it. Bah. I'm going to offer you some solutions, as I always do. It would be irresponsible for me to do otherwise. The answer is very simple. As I've said, since Merce passed, and I've talked about her, and I titled it The Legacy of Merce. It's up on Federal Jack and on YouTube. What did I say to you? How did she live her life? That she was the change that she wanted to see in the world. Was she not? That is the answer. Now, it's very simple on the surface, but below the water, there's more chaos going on because obviously it branches out. But being that change, part of being that positive change means that you don't just jump into things and react emotionally. You sit back and use a little bit of logic. I'm not saying that you have to be a robot and constantly work off logic and never let emotion ever come in. That's what emotions are for. There has to have a fine tune of the two. But logic does have to, you can't make, you shouldn't, I say you can't because you can, but you shouldn't make decisions based off of emotion and without using any type of logic to even look at the situation. If you want to be the change, you have to change within yourself. That's what I mean when I say you have to change inside. Why do you think I wanted to woodshed this place when I came back? Do you think I went on air tonight and ripped the things I don't like about my home country, a new a-hole on air because I hate my country and I'm anti-American? If you think that, and there's probably some right-wing retard putz that'll hear this.
Yeah. America, Army Strong, F this guy, who calls him, grown man, calls himself Popeye, what a dick.
You need to pack your shit up and go to douchebagistan. That's where you belong. You and the people that support torture, 60%. Like I said, it was a C-SPAN, I think it was a C-SPAN thing that they were doing, and people were calling in, and like 60% of the callers were like, woo, America, F yeah, even more. And I believe that there was a poll or something where it was like 60 or 65% of the people in this country were like, yeah, torture's cool. You know, it's all good. Torture's cool. Disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. You people have lost your way. Your moral compass is so effed up, I'm surprised you could find your way to the bathroom. Torture's not cool. And this country, by the way, pretty much as a whole, the country's moral compass is so effed up that I'm surprised that it can collectively find its way to the bathroom. If people started changing from within, it would spread to everybody. You know, if everybody started doing it, right, started looking at themselves, and started just treating others like humans and not being afraid all the time and trying to be more positive, right? The world would be a better place. Oh, that's utopia, Popeye. That'll never happen. No, it can happen. But you actually have to do it. You know, my mother used to say to me all the time, if everybody in the world, this is exactly how she used to say to me when I was a kid, if everybody in the world thought like that, nothing would get done or whatever what I was talking about, right? And maybe that statement had a profound effect on me. I don't know. But she's right. My mother was right. If everybody in the world, or in this case, if everybody in this country starts to live in fear and be constantly afraid of one another and not want to talk to each other, and slowly but surely through you know, whatever different ways, whether it be political beliefs, sexual preference, skin color, whatever, they allow themselves to be divided into smaller little subgroups, and everybody's living in fear. What happens? What if, like my mother said, what if everybody in the world was like that? Well, what if everybody in America was like that? Well, we're getting pretty close. And then they blur the lines, the basics. So nobody even has a guide, and everybody's confused, and they look back. Oh, let me look back in the instruction manual. Suddenly, the instruction manual is all blurred. You can't read any of it. Doesn't matter what language you look it in. Everything's blurred. So you can't even go back to the basics for that, because now there's no structure. Now people don't know what to do. Now they're really scared. They feel alone. What do I do? What do I do? Oh, there's the government on their white horse. We'll save you. Or, I don't like using the word government, the powers that shouldn't be on their white horse. like the hero. And it's all contrived bullshit. They already know what they want to do. They look at you and they go, well, they won't do this unless we do this. And then they come up with the whole plan to manipulate you into doing and asking for exactly what they already wanted to bring about anyway. And they do it through fear, racism, paranoia, but mostly, well, fear feeds everything else. Because it's either love or fear, two frequencies. They get everybody to be all panicky and freaking out. Oh my God, my neighbor could be Al-Qaeda. Your neighbor could also be the nicest person in the world. Did you ever get to know him? No? Well, probably because you're a dick. Maybe your neighbor is a dick. Maybe your neighbor's one of these people that's just an a-hole. Maybe he's not that bad. Maybe he's like that because of experiences in his life. Again, making a quick two-second judgment call on somebody because they acted a certain way. How many people do you know that acted like an ass? And if you got to know them, they were actually really good people. And that acting like an ass thing was a defense mechanism to keep scumbags away. Because maybe they'd gotten messed with or hurt throughout their lives, whether it was a man or a woman. How many times has somebody seen that? Oh, I've never seen that, Popeye. Sure. Sure you haven't. Sure. So quit to judge. I did a show about that, about not judging each other. Not being so quick to jump on each other and attack each other and blame people for things, right? It's actually the last show I did live. If you go back in the archives, it's the one before this. Go listen to it. It's part of the problem. Hello, McFly, anybody home? People, this country has been turned from, and I'm not saying we were, you know, when I was a kid, everything was hunky-dory and there were no problems, but this country has been turned from the idea, and I know there's Masonic roots and everything else, but this country is being drastically turned from at least what we were told were our roots, right, our beliefs, what we grew up being taught, and my father grew up being taught, you know, and my grandfather, these basic ideas. And regardless of the whole Masonic foundation of the country itself and all this other stuff, I'm talking about the basics. We didn't do this stuff. America wasn't a bunch of bullies. We didn't torture people. We didn't condone. Yeah, it happened. But people were appalled at it. People were pissed off and upset about it. Maybe it was because they were younger, right? And they say, oh, America was more innocent. No, I like to think people back then just weren't so dumbed down and so morally bankrupt because of all the programming and all the crap, right? You have to blame people for their individual actions, but society as a whole has been manipulated. You have to understand both sides of the coin. Don't hate the players, hate the game, right? The point is, if you change from within yourself, you'll emanate that positive energy outward, and then others will start to change, and that'll happen. And it's not going to just change overnight, and soldiers are going to drop their guns and be like, yay, peace, love, and harmony, kumbaya, my lord, kumbaya. No, it's not going to be like that. But eventually, it will come to that point where there won't be anybody willing to fight. And they're going to say, yeah, we're not going to do this. And you will come to a tipping point. It's not going to happen overnight because that's just not the way it works. This whole thing didn't come about overnight. I know it seems like it came about overnight, but it really didn't. And fixing the problem isn't going to come about overnight. We have a huge tumor inside of this country, and it needs to be excised ever so efficiently, but ever so gently and professionally. We don't want to just go in and start hacking things up with a chainsaw, spread the cancer to other parts, then we got to start chasing it all over the place. The only way to properly solve any of these problems, because look, if you, what happens if you stand up? You breathe in the wrong direction, cop shoots you, right? Police brutality. They want people to riot. They foment riots. You know, Ferguson thing. Oh, my God, riots, riots, riots. Martial law. They have plans for that. King Alfred plan. You know, Mae Brussel. Go look up the show on YouTube. I've got it. Conspiracy Scope. He's a listener, and he's a great guy. Guy busts his ass putting out the Mae Brussel stuff for you people. You guys should go listen to that stuff. Go over to Conspiracy Scope or Conspiracy Scope 2 on YouTube and check his stuff out. It's just excellent work. Excellent work. And he constantly puts out, you know, all different radio shows. But one of the things he does is he puts up the Mae Brussel archives. And in there, you can either find it on there or it's on one of the Federal Jack channels. Look up the Mae Brussel, the King Alfred plan. It'll pop up on YouTube. Listen to it. I've also done radio shows on it where I've done a breakdown. And you should, you know, go in the archives and listen to it where I played it. And I did a breakdown and I compared it to the 10 FEMA regions. It's really creepy. Anyway, the whole point is they're prepared for this. The only thing that they can contain is violence. That's what they want. They want everybody to fight. The key is to not fight and realize that it's the one same, you know, again, if you're in a group of six or seven people, it's that one friend that keeps stirring it with the stick. You get it? They're playing everybody against each other. That's how they retain control. That's how they retain their power. And the original Federal Jack logo, it had Uncle Jack, you know, with the two puppets, and underneath it, it said, "I want you," like the Uncle Sam posters, and then it said, to argue and fight amongst each other while I retain complete control. And that's exactly what you have going on. People that have seen the original, you know, now the newer ones, I merged the front and the back, and then I did the radio show advertisement on the back. But for the older Federal Jack logos from years ago, people will remember that that's what it said underneath it. And you can go look at pictures, you could still see it, the older ones. It's all a game, ladies and gentlemen, and you're falling for it again. And it's pissing me off because I expect more out of you at this point. I really do. And that's why I did the ass-ripping, wood-shedding show that I did tonight. But I wanted to end it off here with some positivity because I don't think that you're done. Why do you think I came back? If I thought this country was done, I would have just phoned my father and said, "Hey, I'm selling everything over there. I'll figure out how I'm going to sell it off. I'm going to get a place here and I'm staying over here. Screw America." If I really thought that the fat lady had sung and it was over and the ship was going down and there was no saving it, would I have come back? If I didn't think that humanity had potential, would I do these radio shows? If I didn't think you as the American public had potential, if I didn't believe in you, if I didn't love you people, would I have come back? No. I wouldn't have. So that shows you that I believe in every single one of you out there. But you have to do something about this. You have to get up. You have to stop falling for this crap. You have to stop. You know, there's a lot of you smart activists out there that I'll see you post something on Facebook. And I'm like, really, people? And I don't bust your balls. I don't even say anything. I don't call names out or nothing. But, like, it just irritates me because I expect more out of you. Because I respect your intellect that much that I figure, well, these people obviously have to see how incredibly shady this crap is. And sometimes they don't. Sometimes I see some of these very smart individuals sliding right back into the mire and the muck and falling for it. We're never going to get out of this if we keep doing the same crap. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again and expecting a different result. What did Einstein say? You can't solve a problem with the same level of thinking that created it. I'll repeat that. You can't solve a problem with the same level of thinking that created it. Now I'm going to add my own little version. I've said this before. You can't solve a problem with the same level of, same base level of thinking that created it. Because I always say they keep humanity base level. That's what the whole 666 is, by the way. 666, the number of the beast. It's we're the beast. The 666 is humanity. It's base level thinking, base level consciousness. The white checkerboard floor that the Masons use. That's why the cops, some of the police departments have the white checkerboard thing around their thing, because they're base level thinkers. They're very lowest. Oh, I can go on and on and on. Go listen to the shows I've done with Mark Passio about this in my archive section. I gotta get Mark back on. He was supposed to come on and you know, I've had a couple months off, so I gotta call Mark. Anyway, I believe in all of you, ladies and gentlemen. I really do. Or else I wouldn't be even wasting my time talking to you. I'm just highly disappointed in a lot of people. But I love all of you. I respect all of you. And I actually really do believe in you. That's why I'm so agitated. Because I can see your true potential. Maybe some of you can't. Maybe some of you are still, you know, whatever. I'm not being on my high horse. All I'm saying is I love all of you and I respect you enough that I'm willing to come on air and, you know, cry bullshit when I see it. Just the way I am. You could love me or hate me, but I am what I am. I'll see you all again, hopefully tomorrow night. We'll see how I feel. I love you all, and as I tell you all, the solutions to our problems are most definitely an inside job. Ladies and gentlemen, I am out of here.